All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. Thank you all, and welcome to the BMES industry panel. Thanks for joining the Early Career and Student Program. My name is Waji Sadi. I lead the search services of Saddlepoint Biomedical, a specialized recruiting firm in the medical device and nanotechnology industries. I am pleased to moderate this session and introduce our three impressive panelists. I'm going to just remind the panelists and the audience that this session is going to be recorded. And it's going to be audio recorded and will be available on the website afterwards. So just a reminder. So the purpose of this panel is to share career information and provide advice to biomedical engineering students and young professionals in the field. And we have three impressive biomedical engineers who are here to share with us their experience, their educational training, give us some insight into their roles, how they got to this point in their career, some marketing insight or insight into the hiring markets, and share some advice with the audience, with people who may be interested in similar paths. So we have Rachel Hunt, senior project engineer at Teleflex, Nathan Weidenhammer, senior R&D engineer at Medtronic, and Theo Nicholson, R&D manager at Children's Healthcare of Atlanta. So the session will start with brief introductions. Each of the speakers will get up and introduce themselves and tell you a little bit about themselves and their path so far. And then we will go through a series of questions that I will pose to the panel to initiate a discussion. Then at the end of the session, there will be time for Q&A with the audience. I'm just curious if we can have a quick show of hands. How many people are undergraduate students? Excellent. How many graduates? Any postdocs? Excellent. Anyone in industry? Right. Excellent. Okay, so I will go ahead and pass it over to Rachel to introduce herself. If you can.
I'll just stand up so you can see my face. Okay. Well, I'm Rachel Hunt. I'm actually not a senior project engineer anymore. I recently changed roles, but that's okay. I didn't get my information updated in time. Now I'm a project manager. What might be helpful for you guys to know, I went to North Carolina State University for undergrad and did BME there. Is anyone here from NC State? Oh, perfect, okay. Oh yes, y'all were on my plane yesterday, I think, some of you. Perfect. And for grad school, I went to Duke University. Is anyone here from Duke? Maybe, oh, okay, perfect, yes. So I stayed local in the Triangle. If you hear me refer to RTP, in North Carolina, we have this hub of technology, pharma, med device, and we refer to it as RTP, Research Triangle Park. So if anyone ever says that to you in industry, like, hey, I work in RTP, that's all it means. It's just Raleigh-Durham, North Carolina. So I went to NC State, Duke. At Duke, I actually did my master's in engineering management because, like yourselves, I did research in undergrad and I presented at BMES and I just figured research wasn't what I wanted to do in grad school. So I did that custom program at Duke where you can tailor it to take engineering courses and also business courses. So I took MBA courses and engineering courses as part of my Duke program. And then as far as a career goes, my first job was with Teleflex, and I'm still there. So I've been there 6.5 years now. And the way I got that job was through networking with a professor at NC State who had built industry relationships, and he networked me to someone who worked at Teleflex. They created a job for me, got me rolling. Since I've been at Teleflex, I've been in four different positions, And I mean, it's all been wonderful med device. I started out working on respiratory products, and then I moved into just working on surgical products. So I worked on a lot of laparoscopic devices. And now my focus is on ENT, ear, nose, and throat devices. So if you guys had any med device specific questions later on, I can probably help you in those fields. And you know, now I'm a project manager, so I work a lot with quality engineers, R&D engineers, regulatory folks, and I work with marketing and sales as well to understand and develop our pipeline of projects and what we're looking, what projects we're looking to move forward with, what projects we're going to say no to. And then a big part of my role too is going out and meeting with clinicians, surgeons, to figure out what their unmet needs are, to translate that back into our projects. Is that enough for intro?
Yeah.
Okay.
Great. Perfect. Great. Thank you. So next we have Nathan.
Should I stand up?
Yeah, if you can stand up too.
Sure.
Hello, my name is Nathan Weidenhammer. I'm a senior R&D engineer at Medtronic. I think unlike Rachel, my path to where I am today was a bit more tortuous, to say the least. But I also remember being just a few years ago on the other side of this podium, and I'm really happy that this is available to undergraduate and graduate students, postdocs alike, to hear talks from industry and hear what we have to say. So I completed my BS in biomedical engineering at Penn State University. We have a couple of Penns, the people here, that's great. I was actually the member of the first class of, at least the undergraduate class in biomedical engineering, so my entry into industry, no one knew what a biomedical engineer was or what a biomedical engineer could do. Fortunately, that has changed quite a bit. My first job out of my first industry job out of undergraduate was at a small contract manufacturer called Advanced Scientifics in central Pennsylvania. I was working there in product development, you know, very short product development life cycles, and very quick turnaround. After that, I decided I wanted to move more into more heavy research and development, so I decided to attend graduate school. I moved out here for graduate school. I'm a University of Minnesota graduate, PhD in 2013, where I worked with Bob Tranquillo in cardiovascular tissue engineering and regenerative medicine. After my PhD, my first job was found, you know, like Rachel, via networking through a professor in the department who actually spun out a regenerative medicine company in the Twin Cities. I was employed there for, you know, a couple of years as a research scientist working on a SBIR-funded grant. Just recently, 8 months ago or so, I transitioned over to Medtronic, where I work in the endovenous business units, working in deep vein thrombosis, venous valves, pulmonary embolism. And I work in a role that is more of an emerging technologies and trying to understand what new business opportunities are, both what technologies are ready for translation, and as well as, you know, in managing kind of external research collaborations between academia and industry. That's where I am today, and thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Theo?
Hello, I'm Theo Nicholson. I am a biomedical engineer by training and a chemist. My degrees are from Oakwood University, which is a small HBCU in Alabama, and I went to The Ohio State University for my master's and PhD, where I focused on biomedical nanotechnology, surface chemistry, and sensors. I then went on to industry, and similar to Rachel and Nathan, my job in industry was due to a connection via my advisor. And so he had previously worked with an individual that now was CTO of a small company out in Missouri, and he actually came to Ohio State in order to look for biomedical engineers, and he happened to find one. So Through that process, I worked with that company as a research engineer on a wound care, innovative wound care product that they were working on for the military for traumatic wounds. And I was promoted to lead that project. That company, because of its small and government contract nature, was shutting down their R&D about 3 years after I was hired. And so 30 to 40 engineers lost their jobs, me being one of them. I then went back home to Atlanta. I did some consulting work within the medical device industry for a couple of months until I found my next role, which was at Children's Healthcare of Atlanta. That also was due to networking. It's kind of a theme that you'll hear as part of the things that we're saying. It is about who you know, but you need to be prepared for those opportunities when they present themselves. So I started that role in 2014. I've been promoted recently to manager of their research technology development group, and we work on a very small, it's about 10 engineers team, on a medical device development project for the early diagnosis of autism spectrum disorder. Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, or CHOA, is about 10,000 employees, but we are the only group that's operating in the medical device arena specifically. I think that's about it.
Great. All right. Thank you very much for those introductions and for that, those overviews. So the first question that I want to tackle is a basic one, and that is if you can, if each of you can discuss what degrees, types of roles, necessary training is required in your organization, in your company, what type of experience you've seen both in your role and people around you. So we can start with Rachel.
Okay. Well, I've had kind of an interesting experience with this. At NC State, they actually taught a course on FDA design controls, and that's probably a big thing you need to know if you want to go into med device. However, that being said, if you don't learn it when you're an undergrad, it's something you can totally learn on the job. There are mechanical, electrical, biomedical engineers at our company, and I mean, just as a rule of thumb, everyone has to know design control, everyone has to know FDA quality system. And beyond that, if you plan on putting med devices, launching them globally, you have to know those regulations as well. It's just part of being in R&D nowadays with med device. That being said, with the BME undergrad degree that I had, I do feel that when I was interviewing for jobs, I had to kind of sell my degree. Employers didn't always see the value in biomed or exactly know what that degree meant. A lot of times people are very used to, oh, I know what mechanical engineering is, I know what electrical engineering is, why is your degree different? You know, explain it to me. So I found myself having to sell myself and my degree. So I would just be prepared anytime you're interviewing, like have a pitch for your BME degree. You know, it incorporates so many different things, like I have exposure to mechanical, I have exposure to electrical, and I have exposure to medicine in practical application. So really sell yourself on that. I think that will help.
Yeah, I think I'd like to second a lot of Rachel's comments. So within the franchise of Medtronic that I work within, there actually are quite a few biomedical engineers, a lot of them, interestingly, former students of mine. So I was a little bit surprised to find that, because when I first graduated, I was seeing similar sentiments where, you know, we hire a lot of mechanical engineers, we hire a lot of electrical engineers, why should I hire a biomedical engineer? So, you know, it's very promising to see a kind of a change in the perception, at least, you know, it's kind of anecdotal evidence, it's just one example, but I think it's happening. Otherwise, I think it depends on what the role you're looking to apply for. We have mechanical engineers that are designers, we have electrical engineers, we have material scientists, we have biologists, biomedical engineers. again, I think it's really all about selling yourself and demonstrating the interest in medical devices and selling your own personal experiments, make sure it's translatable to where you're interviewing.
I would agree with that. I think if you understand the project and the team that you're working with or you're trying to work with, providing aspects of your experience that match or complement or extend their capabilities is really what you need to do when you're going into those interview situations. As far as your preparedness from academia, I would say looking at courses in quality and systems engineering, which is a big component of the project that I work on. We have software and hardware systems integrated. There's a lot of testing that goes through that, designing those test cases, tracing those test cases to requirements. So the design controls that Rachel mentioned, understanding that process will help you. You can probably figure it out on the job, and there are a lot of things that you can learn on the job and with the team, but having that background as part of your undergraduate experience or graduate experience is very helpful to industry. We are looking for people that understand how to design, test, verify, and then validate these products. And so having any component within that life cycle with under your belt and in your expertise is helpful.
Can you start with Theo. Can you elaborate a bit more on design controls and maybe give maybe a few more examples to people of what's usually involved?
Sure. I can give you what we're working on currently. There's a lot of documentation that the FDA requires. Their regulations build on the ISO standards. I won't list them, my quality engineer would, but it builds on that understanding. So you're taking into account your project plan, how you're handling risk through the course of your product development. You're also looking at your design controls. So how do you define your user needs? How are you defining a stakeholder within this environment? And then how do you build modular requirements to speak to those higher level user needs, or system requirements to even speak to those user needs? And then how you build test cases and trace those back and verify that you've taken care of those risks that you identified early in the project. So it's really, it's an intense process. There is a lot of documentation around it, but if you understand why you're doing that, it can benefit you in your career.
Does anyone else want to add to that or elaborate?
I actually work outside of a lot of these quality controls in tech development and commercial development, but I should mention that we're always cognizant of the documentation practices because ultimately those are going to be transitioned to projects where that's going to become very important. So even if you find yourself working in a role that's kind of outside of the formal quality system and it's still important, very important to understand quality systems.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that. I mean, how many folks in the room are thinking that they want to stay in some sort of research and development type role within industry? Okay, perfect. I mean, in my experience, I have been with the same company, but I really feel that you are allowed to be more innovative if you stay in that R&D role. If you're interested in learning quality controls and learning how med devices are regulated, go into regulatory, go into quality engineering, go into, I think, manufacturing engineering, actually. There's a really heavy quality component built into manufacturing engineering as well, if anyone's interested in doing that. But I mean, R&D, the perfect example this morning, Medtronic, a lot of companies have a lot of money that they're willing to invest to just play around with ideas and figure out what's going to work before they even get it to proof of concept to bring to market. And I mean, that's probably more of what Nathan does, figuring out what ideas are feasible to pursue, what's not going to work. But if you are interested in staying in the R&D umbrella, so to speak, I think that there's really good opportunity there.
Great. So what are you most passionate about in your jobs? What do you like most about your current job? What excites you?
Can you go first? Well, for me personally, my favorite thing about my job is getting out into the field with clinicians and really understand what are their pain points, what can I do to help with their pain points, and then I love taking those ideas back to the table and making business cases around projects. That's just how my brain works. I like to figure out, you know, what's going to work moving forward, put a project plan together, put a business case, present it to senior leadership in industry. That's also another role I'm sure a lot of biomedical engineers end up pursuing, because we're very technical people and we can get into the details of things, but we can also, you know, on a high level present, I think this technical concept will work well, here's why, and with an engineering background, you can really explain it to your audience once you understand all the details. So I think for me, I'm passionate about working with the clinicians who are using our products every day. So anytime I can get into the field and meet with them and understand what's going on, it's awesome. And it's also just good to be immersed in what's going on in healthcare now, understand how hospitals work, what incentivizes hospitals, what incentivizes reimbursement plans for hospitals, insurance companies. It's good to have a foundational understanding of all of those aspects, you know, government regulations, insurance, hospitals, GPOs or group purchasing organizations. How do hospitals buy your products? And it differs in every country. So just understanding that, meeting with your clinicians and understanding what they go through to get your products in the door, it's different in every single market. So it keeps, you know, it keeps things fun and interesting, and that my passion continues to lie there.
Yeah, I'll second Rachel's sentiments, as I agree that going out into the field and talking to scientists and clinicians about the clinical unmet need, about the needs of their patients, and then being able to take that back to the lab or to work outside of the lab with an external collaborator to tinker and to play around that, you know, that's what, you know, as engineers we love to do, to try to come up with something new and innovative, and then also understanding all the other stakeholders involved in the process, you know, as you mentioned, the healthcare providers, the payers, and how that all works together to getting a product to market. You know, you can have a really great technology, but there are so many other barriers to adoption, barriers to entry, and it's just, you learn something new every day, every time you're out in the field, every new conversation you have, and it's something that'll never get old.
Part of the work that I do outside of the medical device development project, which I really enjoy, is technology development. So these are products or tools that researchers can use at the Marcus Autism Center, which is an NIH Autism Center of Excellence, one of three in the country. And so we have the ability to work with these researchers and clinicians that are at the cutting edge of their field in social neuroscience and behavioral disorders. And so my job gets to tell someone, oh, hey, I want to put this thing together, and I don't really know how it's going to work, and this is what we need. And we get together as a group of engineers, we sit down with the researchers, and we figure out how to get them what they need in order to do the cutting-edge research. That's a very small piece of what we do, but it's a very exciting component, and it's an area that I didn't have any previous experience in. I wasn't a social neuroscientist. And so learning about all of these different behavioral interventions and treatments and assessments has been a very exciting part of my job.
Great. So on the flip side, and I'll pose that to all of you, I won't put anyone specifically on the spot, but what are some of the challenges that you guys have experienced, whatever you can comment on?
I will very easily comment on some of the challenges. This is being recorded, correct?
Yes,
so I will broadly speak about the challenges I experienced working for a smaller organization versus a larger organization. There are benefits, pros and cons to each. I think in the smaller organization, it's much easier to move quickly because there is less, I don't want to say red tape, but there are less controls in place to manage change. And so the smaller organization, if you need to hire somebody new or you need to change a process, it doesn't impact as many people, so changing that process is much easier. Working for an organization that has about 10,000 people in it, changing some of these processes that impact over, you know, 80 to 90% of the staff are very difficult, and you have to build a case in order to do that. So I would say those are some of the most challenging aspects, is getting that organization to recognize the need for change and innovation. And we're doing that, but it is a challenge.
Yeah, to move a little bit further on the comments between working at a small company, working at a large company, definitely I agree with what Theo is saying. You know, startups or smaller organizations are much more nimble. Changes can happen a lot quicker, but there's the downside of that is the changes happen a lot quicker. And so there's the unpredictability. You know, a startup company, you've got, excuse me, you've got a year of funding and you don't know what's going to happen next. And, you know, so it's really exciting. You get to work on a lot of more innovative things, things that, you know, large organizations maybe wouldn't be willing to tolerate the risk to do. But, you know, you may be out of a job with money runs dry or something doesn't, you know, you don't hit a milestone. Working in a large organization, I was surprised, and I'm fairly new to working in a large organization. I went from working at a startup of roughly 7 people when I started to a company of 90,000. So very large, many orders of magnitude change. And you'd be surprised how different business units are within a large organization, that my business unit behaves more like a startup or a smaller company. There's a lot less of that, I don't want to say red tape, but a lot of those layers of the hierarchy than what you would think. And so if the fit is right and you really like that fast-paced startup environment, you can still find that at a large company.
Thanks. Yeah, and I'll echo what Nathan just said. I mean, within my company, we have business units just like Medtronic, and they all move at different paces, and they have different ways of doing things. So it can be a challenge if you have the mindset that you want to implement change in your company. Because of what Theo said, there may be layers of red tape. You know, you probably can't do XYZ in this business unit, but you could definitely do it in yours. So with that being said, I would just encourage you guys, when you go for your first interviews, to really interview the company as well. Understand how open are they to making change. There's always room for improvement in med device and in large companies, small companies. Things fluctuate so much with regulations, you have to be able to change quickly to keep up. So I would just encourage you to interview the people, the hiring managers. How open are you to change? What's your team like? What are the people like? And that being said, people, the people you're working with, they could be your biggest asset, but they could also be your biggest challenge. So I think as engineers, understanding, you know, if you want to make change, you have to influence others. And I think that's just an important thing to learn. So as you're out there, as you're networking, as you're meeting people at this conference, you know, just keep that in mind. People make or break your experience at a company. And I think, and day to day, you know, if you walk in the morning and someone has a positive attitude, smile on their face, oh, good morning, like your day at work is just going to be so much brighter. It sounds so silly, but really look for that in the teams that you're interviewing when you're interviewing companies as they interview you. It's just treat it like as it goes both ways.
That's great, and those are all really great insights. Thank you for that. I'll actually comment on what Rachel just said. That's a very important point, is that when you're going on an interview, they're not just interviewing you, you're interviewing them. So you want to understand, is this a good fit for you? And obviously with your first job, the temptation is that, you know, I really want a job, and I'm going to make myself fit. And I understand that, and there's validity to that. But you also really want to make sure that they're a good fit for you and you're a good fit for them technically, also in terms of personality, especially for smaller teams, really kind of pay attention to that. And then another point also could be a challenge, which Rachel just mentioned, is so you're dealing with people, and when you're going through your education, particularly through graduate school, you're taught to be independent, and you're taught to focus on your own project and focus on your own work. In industry, it's all in teams. You know, there are cases, especially in larger companies, where they have very senior fellows and senior, you know, scientist type roles where they can be more independent. But in general, you're working in teams. So that could be kind of an initial adjustment, is how do I work? And obviously when you have senior design projects and stuff like that, you get that experience. But that's definitely a very important thing in breaking into industry, is understanding, you know, how to work in teams, how to work with people, how to influence others.
Yeah.
I also share the same experience in terms of startups and large companies. I've worked in both environments, so I second all of that. Great. So thank you for that. So on to the kind of next topic, which you all touched on at the beginning, is how you've got your first job and how you ended up in this role. So you've talked about networking. Obviously, that's one of the most important things in getting jobs, is through networking, through knowing people. I had the same experiences when I got my first job. So can you talk a bit more about, you know, maybe pivotal points in your career path, certain things that triggered you onto the direction that you ended up in? Do you have any other thoughts that you guys can mention?
Yeah, well, I'll actually share one other story, how I ended up getting my first job at Teleflex. There was another company in the RTP area that I had interviewed with, and I had gone through multiple rounds. Come to find out later that there had been 95 applications for this one position, so it was pretty competitive. We had students from NC State, Duke, and UNC all applying for this one position at the company. So I made it through a few rounds and figured out that at the end I got my phone call like, hey, we didn't hire you, we hired another candidate. I figured that was coming because I got a phone call in the afternoon, not in the morning. But part of that, I mean, that was a big learning experience for me, but if you ever find yourself in this situation, when I was on the phone with the hiring manager, I asked him, I said, well, you know, what would have made the deal? What would have made you guys pick me over the other candidate? At the end of the day, it just came down to the other candidate had experience in an area I didn't have experience in, and their company needed that. So the hiring decision made perfect sense. But, you know, I asked him, can we keep in touch? Can I add you on LinkedIn? Can we still network? Do you have any career advice for me? I'm still looking for jobs. So it turns out about a week later is when I did my initial interview with Teleflex, and unprompted, I hadn't asked this person anything, but they found out, and the hiring manager for the other company called over and gave a recommendation. So, I mean, I thought that was pretty neat. There's people out there who are willing to go the extra mile to help you out. If you just, you know, state your case, explain what you're interested in, explain what your career goals are. People love to help other people out. And I mean, that story, it was very impactful for me, I guess. So that, in addition to networking through professors at my university, that had also happened. I was able to network just by way of interviewing at various companies.
So I actually found my first job just by applying on the website, which is very uncharacteristic, although I think it never happens. And I've had an unusual success doing that, but I don't think that's normal, that's an outlier. But I think the first job really was kind of a right time, right place. So Advanced Scientific was located in a small town of about 2,000 people in North Harrisburg, which is not a very large city to begin with. And I had ties to that area, and I was interested in the position, and it just happened to work out. But I can comment on some of the other positions postgraduate school. My first job out of graduate school was from a connection with a faculty member that worked in the department. It was almost an extension of my graduate research. And my most recent position, I applied online and actually, got a response. But as it turns out, the hiring manager has an external collaboration with my previous advisor and recognized the name. So even though I applied online, there's still that importance of developing your professional network, and whether you actually see it or not, it's probably happening behind the scenes. Someone recognizes your name for some reason or other, and it makes it stand out. And I think that the second part of the question was a pivotal part in your career. I think it was just completing grad school. It helped me realize two things. Is one, that I really love research. I really like thinking about science, talking about science, and to some extent doing the science. And so I've been fortunate to find roles where I can continue to do that, with increasing levels of responsibility, so I'm spending less time at the bench and more time advising students and advising collaborators.
All right, so I'll answer that question with two stories, and I'll get to the second question. Moving from my PhD into industry was due to a poster presentation that a colleague was giving that was on research that we had all been involved in the lab, specifically with my project. And they were just starting out. I think they were a first year PhD student. They met with the CTO, and he really liked the project, and he felt that the skill sets identified in that project would be useful on their team. And so from that, and his connection to my advisor, I was able to get a phone interview with the CTO. I answered his questions thoroughly. I was asking a lot of questions about the project, which I think probably led to him saying, yes, let's go to the next level. I then met with their project coordinator, which essentially was the next level down, and then with the team technical lead. And all throughout that process, I asked a lot of questions about their project and their work and what they were doing, what the team was like, what the organization was like. I don't know how much that contributed to the success that I had in attaining that position, but I think from becoming a hiring manager now, I like those questions. They tend to mean that you want to be in that role, and we want to hire people that we really like, that have the technical skill, but people that also would like to be there, because the fit is about your experience there as well as the organization's ability to use you as a resource for those projects. I'll speak a little bit about how I got my next industry job after I lost my job, was laid off. I essentially told everyone that I knew that I was looking for a job, friends, family, people that I went to undergraduate with, grad school. I was contacting people that I had met as part of my travels in industry at different conferences and meetings and had built some relationships with. And through that, a friend of the family that I'd known for a number of years is working for Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, and he knew about the project that I'm currently working on, and he said, you do biomedical engineering, right? So you kind of know about this. And I said, sure. So I gave him my resume. He circulated it within that organization. They looked at it, and then that's how I got phone calls from that. And the second part of the question, pivotal moment in my career. I was in graduate school. I was 3 years into my PhD. I felt like I was moving very quickly through the program. I thought I knew a good amount about my project. That changed very rapidly when we lost funding didn't receive another round of funding for the project that I was most interested in. And I had to change and shift to another project within the same lab. I had a decision to make. I could either change and shift within the lab. I could I had my master's at the time, so I could just end my work there at Ohio State and go look for a job in industry. Or I could look for other labs around Ohio State University. And I decided to stay and persevere. And I think that decision of staying or just being decisive about what you're trying to do, whether it was stopping the program and looking for another job or staying and completing the PhD or finding another lab, I think that was a point in time where there are many different roads, and I would say that's a pivotal moment. I don't know if I made the right decision at all, but I do know that I made a very decisive decision, and I wanted to do the PhD, and so I claimed that and completed it.
That's fantastic. Thank you. In terms of educational experiences that have shaped your career, you guys have touched upon, you know, regulatory, for example. Talk a bit about that. Any other aspects, perhaps specific courses that have been really helpful for you so far? And a second part to that is, what was missing, perhaps, that you would have liked to have?
The number one thing, I guess, that helped me was writing my dissertation. When I got into industry, I had to do a lot of, in the government role or government contract role, there was a lot of reporting requirements, and there's still a lot of documentation as part of my current role. Having written that document and putting that together, defending it, going through meetings with my advisory committee, it essentially prepared me for a lot of the work that I'm doing in industry. So when someone says, hey, we need you to write this thing, I'm not nervous about it because I know what I can do. And it's not a matter of, hey, I have a great technical skill. It's a matter of repetition. When you do something often enough and you get comfortable with it, I think you tend to succeed as you're presented with that same problem over and over again in different variations. The thing that I would say was missing from my education is probably the team interaction. I had a lot of that in my graduate lab, but I think more so cross-disciplinary teams, which is what you deal with in industry. I didn't get a lot of that at Ohio State. We did collaborate with labs, but they were all engineers. They weren't necessarily like chemists or biologists or in different areas. And so I think that is something that if you have the opportunity, speak with people that are in the School of Business, speak with the attorneys. These are the people that you're going to talk to in your industry job. I meet with a patent attorney. We recently had a very large contract that we were trying to put through. I met with her, I want to say, three or four times a week at least, and a lot of check-ins, a lot of interaction. We meet a lot with our business strategy folks, and so you need to be able to communicate in those arenas, and I think doing that now in graduate school or undergrad is helpful.
I'll talk about a course that I didn't take that I wished I would have taken, you know, knowing what I know now. There's a course at the University of Minnesota called the New Product Development Business Development course that's offered to graduate school, and it's exactly what Theo was talking about. It's a cross-disciplinary course. There's engineers, physicians, MBAs that work on an industry project, coming there, you know, working with a project definition, coming up with feasible solutions, going down to prototyping, and actually, in some cases, generating IP and creating products. I wish I would have had that taken advantage of that opportunity when I was in school. But what I could say is your senior design is exactly that, just in a kind of a shorter format. It's one of these courses where you get out of it what you put into it. And so I think that's really important. And as for what I think is lacking, or maybe not emphasized as much as it should be, are the kind of quality design controls and understanding FDA regulations, which is usually incorporated somehow into the senior design. But I think almost having a full course dedicated to that in curriculums would be advantageous.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you guys. Although, I mean, engineering, our discipline, it's very rigorous coursework. It's very technical. But the courses I've probably benefited most from in my current industry position are those ones where you took a leap of faith and, you know, took something outside of just your engineering technical courses. So the ones that come to mind, IP valuation, if anyone's ever interested in filing for a patent, I encourage you to take any type of patent law or patent process course just so you understand, you know, how much it costs, what it looks like, when you bring in a patent agent, when you bring in a patent lawyer. And to Theo's point, I would encourage you, while you're a student, meet with patent lawyers, meet with clinicians, especially if you have a medical school on your campus. It's very easy to walk in and say, I'm a student of this campus, I'm just here to learn, no pressure. You have no industry ties, there probably won't be any non-disclosures or non-competes or any legal paperwork that you have to fill out just to get a face-to-face meeting with a clinician. So I would encourage you to meet with those people, meet with patent lawyers, and if anyone's interested in, starting their own company, maybe, show of hands, if anyone has any ideas and you're thinking about starting your own company, go ahead and meet with some venture capitalist type people, just so you understand what that process looks like, what it takes to get funding, understand what angel investors are, be able to make business pitches. That was another class that was helpful, just how do I present, how do I make a business case, how can I present my company in, five slides or less and make someone believe that my company is the most revolutionary thing out there. Those types of classes where you just kind of go out of that very technical engineering role, I would encourage you to take them, at least to get exposure. And if anything, it'll probably help in your interview discussions, saying, I've had experience doing this, and I actually worked on a project team, and we got, XYZ done in undergrad or grad school.
Those are excellent points. I couldn't agree more. And one of the courses that was very interesting for me when I was a PhD student was a class titled Entrepreneurship for Scientists and Engineers. And what it was is it was someone with an MBA was teaching the course. He was giving us the basics of entrepreneurship and business, which was very eye-opening. But then we had a series of speakers from industry who were entrepreneurs. So that was very eye-opening, and like you guys said, a different perspective than what we're used to in science and engineering. So I definitely agree, getting different perspectives while you're still in school, before you get into the, into industry is very important and very helpful. Excellent. So what would you say, maybe this is rehashing some of the same points, but what would you say is the most influential person in your career, perhaps, you've talked about your advisors, anybody else that you came across, perhaps, that has been also been very influential?
Yeah, I think for me, I've had a few of those people once I started working in industry. When you're in school, it's a little bit easier when you're assigned an academic advisor or you have, upperclassmen that you can ask questions of and look up to and get advice from. But when you're in industry, a lot of times you really have to go after that yourself if you're interested in being mentored and seek someone out. Honestly, what I did the first year at my company, I just watched how people operated, how they conducted themselves, how they interacted with other people on the project teams, and just subconsciously, I guess, decided I want to be like that person, and I want to manage my teams the way they manage their teams. They seem to have great success. So that was one thing that I just took initiative of on my own, and I would encourage you to do the same in industry. Find those people. Maybe they're in your company, maybe they're not in your company. I mean, for me, a lot of the people I learn the most from, I'm in a big company, but they're actually in a small startup environment, and there's so much to learn from them. So there have been a few people over the years, and I would just encourage you to look for them.
Other than the obvious, your parents and your mentors and advisors, I think maybe I take a different view on mentorship. Is I know very few people who, if you ask them to honestly tell you if they've had a mentor that's been a lifelong mentor, that would say yes. However, there are a lot of opportunities, just like Rachel was saying, is to meet as many people as possible at your company, outside of your company, local trade organizations are great. They're there to help you network and form these. I don't know if I'm making this turn up, these micro mentorships where you know you keep up with them. You understand the work that they're doing and think of them when you know that light bulb goes off and you become a connection and keep in touch with them. And you know they'll help you when you need them. You help them when they need you. And I think those are the most collectively are the most valuable relationships.
I would say for me, there are two people that I can point to that aren't in the normal vein of a parent or advisor. One of those individuals worked in the lab as a professional while I was in grad school. He used to tell me to get my act together and, hey, it's going to get much harder than it is here in grad school, and you have to realize that. And I didn't really listen, but he was right. Each stage that you move forward, there are new challenges and opportunities that you can take advantage of. And so having the mindset of, hey, I need to approach this with a new excitement and with a level of commitment that will allow me to succeed, I think that was good. It took me a while to get there, though. And the other is a board member of the company that laid me off. I actually talked with him on several occasions while I was working for the organization, and I've talked with him and the CEO. That company still it still exists, and it does commercial. It has commercial products, and so I speak with him probably on a quarterly basis. I was sort of surprised that he wanted to keep up with me after I no longer worked for the organization, but he's been a valuable resource. He owns another company that's out of New York. In the nanotechnology arena, and so he's provided insight there, and it kind of gives you a bird's eye view of what's going on in technology. So I would always keep in touch with people whenever you can, and it doesn't have to be something where you're just, hey, let me check in with you every week, but find someone that's doing something that you're interested in, and if you talk to them once or twice a year, that can really build a connection that may help you 5 or 10 years down the road, and you wouldn't even realize it. So what I would say.
One piece of advice I heard is that, you know, think of who you haven't contacted in a year and write to them. So maybe spend time once a week or once every 2 weeks, sit down and think about who have not kept in touch with and try to keep in touch with them.
Yep.
All right, great. So this may be kind of the last topic before Q&A. What roles are a good fit for biomedical engineers within your companies? So aside from what you're doing, what else do you see things that BMEs can do?
I'll directly speak to quality engineering and regulatory. I think that's a very good area for BMEs to get into. It also depends on what your technical expertise is. And so if you have a technical expertise in programming, for example, that's very useful in my organization. But if you don't, we also have people that have a mechanical engineering background, some people with a more systems engineering background. So I would say the BMEs that we've hired are a quality engineer. We've hired an electromechanical engineer. That's a BME. And we most recently hired another quality engineer that has a BME background. So. Sorry.
I think I might be a little bit optimistic on the view, but I say anything. You know, I see biomedical engineers within my organization that are working in quality, in R&D, manufacturing, regulatory, marketing, sales, executives, business, patent lawyers. You know, it's really... nothing is off the table. It's just what are your interests, what are your skills, and what you would like to do. You know, I think it's not always the easy route to make the, some of those transitions. So maybe you start as a design engineer or a test method development engineer, something of that sort. But you know, particularly Medtronic, there's a lot of emphasis on professional development and to be able to get you those exposures to other areas that pique your interest. And if you're looking for a change outside of the very technical engineering world, that's definitely possible.
Yeah, and just some experiences. I've had some of the best marketing people are engineering background for whatever reason. They can look at a problem, technically a market problem, and you know, figure out, you know, I have solution A, solution B, solution C. Let's come up with which one's going to work. So I was going to say, don't ever limit yourself to just stay in the R&D bubble, especially in med device. You can move around a lot. So marketing and you mentioned sales. One interesting experience I had coming out of undergrad, there was one of the large orthopedic players. They actually had this, I guess it was like a project where they were interested in recruiting only biomedical engineers to be their sales reps. So they came to our university, they went to a lot of universities in the area, and they were recruiting BMEs to be their technical sales reps. A lot of these sales rep jobs in med device, you have to understand how the surgical procedures performed. You have to understand anatomy, physiology, what a surgeon's dealing with. And then, you know, if you work in sales, I guess, for Medtronic, you really have to understand pacemakers, how they work, any of the diabetic equipment. And people with that technical skill set, they love for them to be in the field doing sales. So first of all, you get, if you're a people person and you like that person-to-person interface every day and you like not sitting in a cube from 8 to 5, that might be a great opportunity for you to do sales. Not to mention med device sales, you know, you can do pretty well in those jobs. So I thought that was interesting that a lot of companies, they are very interested in recruiting engineers to do their technical sales.
One other thing I'd add is systems engineers. Just like BMEs are very broad and they understand a lot of different things, systems engineers have to understand things on the system level and understand multiple components. And so that could also be a good opportunity for biomedical engineers because they often have this broad view and this big picture view of a product or a technology. Okay, well, thank you all very much. This is a great discussion. I'd like to open it up to the audience if anyone has questions, and we can have, and if you don't mind stepping up to the mic, that would be best. There are a couple of mics in the hallway so that everybody can hear you. There's quite a few people. Thank you.
Hello, test. We good to go? All right. So, first of all, I just want to say thank you guys for coming out here today, share some of your insights. I think it's really great feedback you guys are providing, and I think it's really honest, really helpful, and I appreciate it. Thank you. Then I want to say sorry in advance if this is not like the best question, but it's something I want to ask, so I'm just going to go ahead and do it, I guess. From my perspective, you know, there's a lot of really cool companies doing a lot of really cool things, you know, a lot of really cool projects going on at this time. And, you know, like you guys mentioned, there's so many factors involved, from the size of the company, to your own personal interests, to the people you work with, to job location, workload, whatever. You know, all these go into the decisions you have to make. And there's really so many options, you know, there's a fair amount of opportunities, it seems like. And I feel like it's easy to get caught up in this kind of paralysis by analysis, you know. And from my perspective, all your experiences really build on each other. But my question to you guys is, like, how do you decide what you really want, where you really want to be, how do you know where you belong, and how do you find the right fit for you? Does that make sense?
You don't. I hate to say it that way, but just as you prefaced your question, you should just go out there and say, hey, this is my question, this is what I want to know. The preamble isn't necessary as I'm giving a preamble now. But I don't think that you can 100% know about a fit until you're in the job for probably about a year. Because in the first 30 to 60 days, you're learning the job, you don't really know anything. Then you get about 6 months in, you start actually contributing and performing at a level that's useful to the team. Then you get about a year in, and now you've seen some of the areas of opportunity, which is a code word for challenges, and you've seen some of the successes and strengths that you've had. So I would say you do the best that you can in analyzing all of the jobs, build yourself some sort of metric where you score all of the different factors that you care about, and then tally it and say, hey, I'm going to make a decision and go with this group. I don't think there is a right answer to the fit question. Not at the time that you're making the decision. There are just factors that you won't know until you work for that organization. But yeah.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thank you. No problem. Great question.
Hello. Hello. I know. So most of you guys have had experience with research and industry. And I know most of us are like either in senior design, have had senior design, think about senior design. And it's like pretty stressful. It's the first like application of research. So I was wondering if it's this, if you feel a similar amount of stress, if it's less stressful, if it's even more stressful in industry as opposed to undergraduate or your graduate research.
I guess it depends on which day you ask me that question. Sometimes it can be slightly more stressful, but you know what? You manage it. Like what was brought up earlier, you work on a team. The team, you know, when a team succeed, when you succeed, the team succeeds, everybody succeeds. If you maybe don't hit a milestone, it's the whole team that's not hitting that milestone in industry. And in industry, it's if something's happened, you know, you can look into the future and say, we have some risk here, this might not go as planned. You always have opportunity to say, well, what can we do right now to fix this, to make it better? It differs a little from senior design. You guys have, you know, we start at point A and we're going to graduate and get out of here. And in industry, you know, you answer, you know, give your quarterly updates or your end of year updates on this is the status of this project and here's how it's going. So for some that might be a little more stressful, but honestly, in industry, when you're in that team environment and you all want to succeed and do well, it doesn't come across that way, in my experience.
In good companies, you're measured by performance, and people who don't perform don't do well. So obviously, there's stress there. But one thing you learn is as you progress in your career, you get stronger, and you can handle more of the stress. But along the lines of what Rachel said, teams are really important, and a good company is one that has good support for you. So if you are left in a role with no support and you're kind of lost and don't know what to do, it's probably not a very good, you know, place for you. So when you go interview, you want to make sure that who are people who can be mentors for you, who are people who are more senior, when you get stuck, you can go to.
All right, thank you.
Next question.
So all three of you at some point chose to go to graduate school at some point in your lives. So would you say that additional experience that you gained in graduate school played an important part in helping you to get a job in industry?
You know, I would say yes and no. For my own personal development in being able to think critically, to think analytically, and then be a better problem solver, I think in that sense it helped me. But I'm not necessarily sure if my employer or other employers for that matter value it the same. It's not to say that, you know, you can't get a PhD and go to industry. It happens for a lot of people, but I think the on-the-job experience is more important.
Next question. Thank you.
Hi, so my name is Steven. I'm from Louisiana, which isn't the largest biotech place in the country. And so I'm currently applying for internships, and then I'll be applying for jobs in another year. So it's a two-part question. First, where normally do people apply for jobs online besides maybe Indeed or Glassdoor? And then since I'm applying for jobs in other states, what are important things, since I guess my resume is the number one thing that I'm putting out there, what are some important things that I should be putting on my resume besides GPA and major?
I'll be honest, I tend not to look as closely at GPA or major. I look at major if
I'm unsure if their degree, so if I look at their focus area, if I'm unsure if the degree is capable of doing the job. But really what I'm looking at is what are the research experiences that they've had? What are the things that they've actually done outside of the curriculum? Because if I'm hiring someone right out of school, I need to know that they can perform tasks, because that's how industry works. You're part of a team, you're assigned tasks, you have contributions that you make as part of that role. So I need to see that you can do that. I would, if I was comparing directly to individuals, I'd start to look at the GPA, but I'm still probably going to call both of those individuals, talk with them, see how they answer questions when it comes to challenges they face during their program, successes that they've had, failures that they've had, what excites them. These are all questions that I ask as part of my interviews because I want to know what makes that individual tick and why are they in this room with me or on the phone with me in the first place. Like, do they care to be here, really, is a really good way to assess the fit. And then you can ask a lot of technical questions as well, but I'm looking most at fit, because if you're in the interview, I've already assessed your resume and said, you can probably do this job at a technical level.
Yeah, I don't look at GPA within reason, you know, unless it's some sort of red flag. I focus more on the research experience and the extracurricular experiences. I want to look and see what are you doing outside of school? How are you balancing multiple responsibilities? How are you managing your time? Because, you know, it's certainly difficult to do that as a student. You've got a full-time student. You maybe have a job. Maybe you're doing something else. These are things I look at. And I also focus on the phone interview and just how you respond to questions. As for applying for jobs outside of your geographic area, I think the best that you can do is to try to tap into maybe an alumni network. Look and see where recent alumni have landed. If there's a trade show or if there's anything, you know, within where you are, go talk to people. Sometimes applying to companies' websites work, sometimes it doesn't. But if you're able to somehow make some connection, whether it's your own interests, whether it's your mutual alumni, something like that.
And just one plug I'll add here. This past year, we've started industry networking groups for BMES within various cities. So I don't know about Louisiana. But I know in RTP we have one, San Francisco, Bay Area, Twin Cities has one, Indiana, I'm not entirely sure where in Indiana, but there's one in Indiana, and there maybe Boston, there's a few more. And I'm thinking practically maybe it would work to your advantage to contact I'm the RTP president, but to contact, you know, the local chapter president and say, hey, I'm involved in BMES, you know, there's your networking in right there. And then they would have, you know, potential for multiple networking opportunities they could share with you, especially since you're coming from a remote location.
And maybe you can start one. Start some kind of a network.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Rachel, and I'm a second year PhD student currently. When I graduate, I would really like to get into more of a management role in a company. And so I guess my question is, what can we do as students to make us more suitable for a role like that?
So one thing I'll say real quick is going back to trying to take maybe a business class or trying to get exposure to these things is definitely helpful.
I think whether you realize that or not, you're already developing those skills. And it's how you present that to your potential employer. So you're probably managing undergraduates. You know, you're managing their projects, you're managing their time, you're evaluating their performance, and probably most importantly, you're developing them. And that's really that's what a good manager does, is they develop individual contributors. So I would reflect on that and think about what are the soft skills that you're learning in graduate school, how you've applied that, and I think Bringing that to the interview will help a lot. And the other thing is becoming a manager. I think it's something I'm not a manager, so I don't know if I'm the best person to to comment. But I think it happens organically. You know, so it may be something where you start as an individual contributor, you express that interest and develop it as you go.
I'd like to say one follow-up to that real quick, share a quick story. One person I knew had graduated with a master's degree, was looking for a job and was looking for a couple months. And as he was looking, part of his extracurricular activities is he had a meditation group that he was running, essentially, with different people. So one of the people there was working at a company and had some senior position and looked at him and said, "You're a really good manager. Would you like to come work for me?" So, you know, any kind of activities that you have or you're interacting with people, you're bound to meet professionals. And the way you deal and interact with them will really help you down the line.
And just to, excuse me, just to echo that, I would say put those leadership skills, the soft skills, on your resume. Because people won't know what you can do unless you tell them. So put that on your resume. Whether you were a lab manager or you manage undergrads or you led a group and did certain projects, put it on there. People will ask you about it, and then you can speak about those skills specifically and get into detail in the interview process. So yeah, good question.
Great. Thank you. Next question.
Thank you very much for the panel review. I think it's safe to say we all learned a lot here today. You spoke a lot about the choices you had to make when you were figuring out where you wanted to go in life, whether that was a small company, a big company, research, or other. Did you ever have to decide between private and public? I know, NIH is public and Teleflex is private. How did you make that choice?
So I want to say I'm still in the private sector because both CHOA and the company I worked for previously are now publicly traded. We are supported by government funds in some aspects of our research and also by donor funds. So I'd still say it's private, but in order to make that choice, you have to evaluate what those different companies do and who are they answering and to whom are they answering. So figuring that out and if that's the environment you want, I think those are the questions that you ask if you're making a choice between public and private. And you need to find people that are at companies in both sectors and ask them, hey, what's your experience like? And based on those answers, you can figure out, are those things that you want to do in your career, or do you want to take a different path? And I guess we're out of time.
Thank you. Next question.
Hi, my name is Morgan Elliott, and I wanted to thank you all for answering questions so thoroughly. Beyond that, a question I had was, you've gone over what jobs BMEs can look for and what's available there, but beyond that, what jobs should bachelor students versus PhD students versus master students be focusing on? And where would their skills, what jobs would differentiate on that?
I can't remember what the adage is, but I think for a bachelor's degree, they consider you basically no experience. I think with a master's, you get granted maybe 2 to 3 years of experience, and with a PhD, 3 to 5. And so when you're looking for jobs, keep that in mind. So if it says, hey, this is a bachelor's level job, but we require 3 years experience and you have a master's, apply. And indicate what those experiences are that you have that make you a fit for that role. I don't tend to read cover letters a lot. I used to a lot more than I do now. So you need to tailor that resume to each position that you apply for and highlight the job skills, I guess, that you have that match those roles. And so maybe in one resume, I talk a lot about management because that's, I want to become a manager in that organization. In another, if I want to just work as a tech transfer development sort of person, I'm going to highlight that aspect of my background. So I think those are the kind of things that you need to tailor your resume for each position you're applying to, or at least have a general resume for like R&D, design, engineer, project engineer, or
you know, manufacturing engineer. Those are all very different roles, and you need to speak to your skills in each of those.
So we're out of time. I'm going to take one last question over there. But the speakers will be available for a little while, and we can move the discussion over to the career zone in the exhibition hall. But if you go ahead and ask if you have a quick question.
So I'm an international student, and that means I don't have any citizenship or GC. So I'm not authorized to work here, and I need a company to sponsor me for H-1B in the future. So I've already done my first year in master's in bioengineering, and I was not sure whether it would be a higher chance for me to get hired if I try for a co-op, an intern, or should I just directly apply for a full-time job?
Definitely, co-ops and internships are always very helpful, and you know, especially if there's a sponsorship for a visa, work permit, green card, something like that. If the company knows you and knows that this is a really good person worth investment, it definitely helps. So, but we can continue this discussion one-on-one if you'd like.
Thank you so much.
And thank you all very much for attending. And as I said, the speakers will be in the career zone available to take more questions.